Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of the pastors here at the Rock.
Myself, we're going to be sharing the message today. It's always fun when we get to do something like this. It's unique. And so today as we approach the Word of God, it's not Pastor Luke, it's not myself, not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, or any other color we could imagine. It's about us coming together and hearing from the Holy Spirit. So if you have the ability, would you stand to your feet? Let's honor the Lord together. I'm going to get down on my knees. Let's go before the Lord together in prayer. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, today we're grateful. Grateful for Jesus, our risen Savior. Lord, grateful that he's at the right hand of the throne of God. Thank you, Lord, that you went to the cross and you died and you bled, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you went to the grave, God, but you didn't stay there, God, that you are risen indeed. And so today we live in that reality, God. We live for you because of that. Thank you, Lord, that you gave us of your Spirit. And today as we open up your word, God, we pray that you would open it up to us. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. Lord, may we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Today, God, we give our interest and our attention, but Lord, we know that you'll do your part. Holy Spirit, be welcome in this place. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we would ask it for our brothers and sisters here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, those that are preaching and proclaiming the gospel of our Lord. They're our brothers and sisters, God, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and co-workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, bless those this day that are celebrating, no matter how large or small, God, non-denominational, denominational, God, we love them, Lord, and we lift them up to you, God, and pray that you encourage and excite them for the kingdom of God and for your advancement, Lord. We give you the glory and the honor and the praise. God, today also we remember our persecuted brothers and sisters around the planet, God, that are suffering, God. We pray that you comfort them and strengthen them, heal them and encourage them. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say, amen. Amen. Today, get your Bibles out as you're having a seat. Go with me to the book of Matthew, chapter number 28. Title of today's message, if you're taking notes, is Risen. We're talking about our risen King, Jesus. Matthew chapter 28, Jesus is now risen. They've posted a guard at the tomb. Now here come some ladies, they're wanting to go, and they're wanting to see the place where he lay. The angel comes down, and as the angel comes, here he rolls the stone away, and as he's doing it, just the power of God is so great that all of the Roman soldiers just pass out right in front of him. So the women come to find the body of Jesus, and here's the angel, and he says these words, and these words speak to us today, Easter 2015. Look at what it says in Matthew chapter 28, verse number 6. It says, he is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. Now I find in these words from the angel to these ladies that came to see Jesus and to see the place where he lay, that there's something that God is speaking to us today about the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. There are a couple of things that we're going to take a look at today as we go through the message that speak to our lives right where we're at here in 2015. The first thing is that the resurrection is real. This is a reality for each and every one of us. There have been people all throughout time who have been skeptical. People who have tried to criticize, people who have tried to say that it wasn't real or that it didn't happen. In fact, even the religious leaders of the day tried to circulate a story that the disciples came and stole away the body. And yet all they had to do to squash the way and to stop that from spreading was to produce a body. If they could go and find out where the disciples took Jesus away to, they could just produce the body of Jesus and stop the whole thing right then and there. Or if the disciples couldn't steal the body away, then they should have just gone to the tomb and got his body and brought it out and said, look, here he is. He's still dead. And yet they never did that. And we know that it's a reality in our lives. You know, one of the reasons why I know it's a reality is when you look at the accounts is that the Romans were involved. You say, well, what does that have to do with it? Here's the thing about that. The moment that the Jews turned Jesus over to the Romans, what happened was it took it out of their hands. The disciples no longer had power. The Jews no longer had power. Now the Roman system was going through. Because, see, the Romans were under authority. They had their systems of doing things. And when there was a command that was given, they were to carry it out to their own peril. See, if it wasn't carried out, if Jesus was handed over to be crucified and he never went to the cross, then there was going to be a dead Roman soldier because they didn't do what they were told to do. Let's take a look at it. You're there in Matthew chapter 28. Turn back with me a couple pages to Matthew chapter 27. And we're going to be in verse number 62 through verse number 66. Take a look at it with me. It says this in Matthew 27, verse number 62. starting, it says, on the next day, which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered together to Pilate, saying, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive how the deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will rise.'" Verse 64, "Therefore, command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people, 'He has risen from the dead.' So the last deception will be worse than the first." Now, I want you to notice, they didn't just do this on their own authority. The Jews didn't just go out to the tomb and do anything. No, they had to ask permission, and they had to get Romans involved because it was out of their hands now. And so they're saying, "We think that there's going to be a plot where the disciples come and steal Jesus away. Therefore, make it secure." Now, look at the response of Pilate, the Roman ruler at that time. Pilate said to them, verse 65, "You have a guard. Go your way. Make it as secure as you know how." In other words, do everything that you want to do, whatever it is, whatever security measures you have, whatever it is that you want to take place, I want you to go and to make it as secure as you know how. So they go, they have a guard, they post a guard. Now that guard, once again, if they would have been caught napping on the job and fallen asleep, they'd have been dead. If they would have had the stone, see, they put an insignia, the Roman insignia, and they pressed wax onto it, and they put their ring and that insignia on there so that they would know that that tomb had been sealed. Therefore, they put every security measure in place that they knew how. Verse 66, "So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guard." See, there was an involvement of the Romans. Therefore, we know that the disciples did not come and steal away the body because they were no match for these Roman centurions. And yet, people still say, "Well, is it a reality? Did it really happen?" Well, how about this one? The eyewitnesses. See, there were accounts of people who saw Jesus after the resurrection. They touched him. They felt him. They ate with him. And they knew that Jesus was alive. You're there in Matthew 28. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Take a look at this. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we find an eyewitness account. This is the Apostle Paul writing to the Corinthian church about the resurrection, about Jesus Christ. And he speaks about the eyewitness accounts of the people who saw Jesus after he was raised from the dead. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse number 3, we're going to read through verse number 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 3 starts out and says, "For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." Verse number 5, "And he was seen by Cephas," or by Peter. He said Peter saw him, but not only Peter, then by the 12. Now, sometimes people say, "Well, wait a second, okay, there's got to be something to that because they were all part of the inner circle. They were the 12. Maybe they all had the same delusion all at the same time. Maybe they were so distraught and emotionally in an uproar that they all thought that they saw Jesus. Maybe there was some incense burning that had some stuff in it that they all started to hallucinate or something like that, and they all had that same delusion." Well, can I ask you this? Have you ever heard of people having the same delusion together? I've never heard of that in my life. They might be smoking the same thing, but they have a different deception coming on them. Some of you guys in this place know what I'm talking about. Just you don't have to say amen or anything like that. It's okay. All right, we're not here to spread your business. But if that's the case, what about the next verse? Take a look at this. Verse 6, "After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep," or some have died. So, in essence, you know what the apostle's saying? He's saying, if you really want to know, just go ask him. Just head on over there. There's 400 and some odd people that you can talk to. "Did you really see Jesus?" "Yes." "Did you really see Jesus?" "Yes." "Did you really see Jesus?" "Yes." "Did you?" And on and on and on and on. You want to find out if Jesus is risen? Go talk to Peter. Go talk to the 12. Or there's about 500 people running around that all saw him at the same time. That can't be a hallucination. Come on, somebody. This is the reality. It really happened. But he goes on and he says, "After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles." See, numerous times Jesus showed up with infallible proof that he was risen. "Then last of all, he was seen by me also, as by one born out of due time." See, sometimes people think, "Well, I can't ask any questions. I can't have any skepticism in my life." But you remember doubting Thomas? Why is doubting Thomas important? Here's why. Because if you're in this place today, and maybe you're new, or maybe you've been coming for a while, but you have questions and you're skeptical about this, you're seeking, that's okay. Keep seeking the Lord, because God will reveal himself to you just like he did to doubting Thomas. What did he say? Thomas said, no, I don't believe it, you guys. I wasn't here when you saw him. And until I put my finger in the nail prints in his hands and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. What happened? Jesus showed up, right? This time Thomas is with him. And he says, Thomas, get over here. Go ahead. You want to know that I'm real? Go ahead. Put your finger there. Come on, Thomas, right here. That's where they put the spear in. Go ahead. And he felt it. And what did he do? He fell down at the feet of Jesus. And just like Thomas, skeptics throughout the ages, great thinkers of our day and of our time have fell down at the feet of Jesus. I think of C.S. Lewis, who was a skeptic. And eventually people around him, were great thinkers as well, were ministering to him and teaching him the word of God. And eventually he says that one day after a motorcycle ride, at the end of that motorcycle ride, he was just born again. And then later on he wrote that I see the resurrection written on every leaf in spring. I think of Josh McDowell, who was a skeptic, and they asked him, what made you cross over, Josh? What made you become a Christian? He says, because I looked at the resurrection, and I couldn't prove it wrong. Therefore, it had to be real, and therefore, if it's real, then I've got to give my life to Jesus. I look at Lee Strobel, an investigative reporter who went out to disprove the resurrection. And at the end of his investigations, he saw that there are not only commentaries in the Bible, but also people who were skeptical, people who were opposed to Christianity, that still proved the reality of the resurrection. And therefore, he concluded that this thing is real and gave his heart and life to Jesus. This is a real thing. And if it's real, then it's real for you and it's real for me. I think the last reality that we see, though, is the greatest one for us today in our time. Not only the Roman involvement, not only the eyewitness accounts, but how about this one, the testimony of a changed life. See, I mentioned Josh McDowell a moment ago, and Josh McDowell in his book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict, talked about if somebody could not run a four-minute mile. But then he came along and he said, you know what, I'm able to run a four-minute mile because I have a stewed tomato in my right shoe. People would think you're crazy. But then he would put on that shoe with the stewed tomato, tie it up, lace it up, and then he would go and run. And if he ran a four-minute mile, you'd say, there's something to that. Now, that would be one thing. You might think, oh, he's just special. Maybe there's something in the tomato. Maybe there's something going on there. But then if other people started to put on a shoe with a stewed tomato and they started running a four-minute mile, you would start to say that there really is something. See, there is the power of a testimony, the power of a changed life. And in our lives, when we look around and we see people who present day are being touched by Jesus. See, if there was no power of a changed life, then this thing would have petered out a long time ago. Yeah, the disciples would have gotten things going and they would have kept things going for a little while. But eventually, if there wasn't a real life change, then people would have said, there's nothing to this. I'm going to go find out what else is out there. But for thousands of years, people have come and given their hearts and lives to Jesus, and they've been touched, and they've been changed, and it's true today. I can tell you myself that when I gave my heart and life to Jesus, everything changed. Nothing was the same. The air was different. The sunlight was different. The birds singing. It was all brand new. I think of the little girl who wore a cross to church. And a sanctimonious Christian came over to straighten her out and says, little girl, don't you know that the cross that Jesus hung on, it wasn't beautiful like the one that you're wearing. It was an ugly wooden cross. And she says, oh, I know that. But they told me in Sunday school that whatever Jesus touches, he changes. Hallelujah. Finally today, as Pastor Luke comes, he's risen. Not only is it a reality, but because he's risen, there's a reach. There is a reach of the resurrection. It reaches out. Sometimes people say, yeah, it's true, and I understand that, but how does that apply to my life? What goes on? Let me take a look at it in the book of Acts. In the book of Acts, the Apostle Peter, one of the eyewitnesses, is now preaching the gospel to people who they didn't think could receive the gospel at the time. They thought it might have only been for the Jews. Maybe it was just for the kingdom to be set up, for the Jewish nation. And yet here's Peter, and God had led him to a house of people who were outside of the covenants of God. People who they thought at the time, maybe it's not for them. And yet God reveals, no, this is for everybody. And so as Peter preaches the gospel, look at what he says in Acts chapter 10, verse number 39 through verse number 43. Peter says this, he says, and we are witnesses of all the things which he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging on a tree, verse 40. Him God raised up on the third day and showed him openly. not to all the people, but to witnesses chosen before by God, even to us who ate and drank with him after he arose from the dead. Verse 42, and he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that it is he who is ordained by God to be judge of the living and of the dead. Verse 43, to him all the prophets witness that through his name, whoever, everybody say whoever. See, whoever means whoever. Whoever means you. Whoever means me. Whoever means the deepest, darkest parts of Africa and Asia and the unreached peoples on the islands. Whoever means in Australia and whoever means in America, North and South and Latin America. Whoever means whoever. All over the world, whoever believes in him will receive the remission of sins. The resurrection reaches to you and it reaches to me, which brings us to the third part today, Pastor Luke.
So we've talked about the reality, the fact that it happened. We've talked about the reach, understanding that because Jesus Christ, his message is for all. Today I want to conclude by looking at the result. Because of his resurrection, what does that mean for you and I? Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the result is that we are now in him. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to Ephesians chapter number 1. I wish we could take the time to read all of Ephesians chapter 1. Paul is exhorting the church, and it's just such an uplifting statement. But I believe as we look into the scriptures, as we look into what Paul is writing here to you and I, as he's speaking to us, his church, celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ on this Sunday, we begin to realize that there's something that happens to us because of what Jesus has done, because of his resurrection. And that is the result in our lives. In Ephesians, the very first chapter, we're going to begin looking at verse number 7. Paul the Apostle says these words. He says, in him, that's to you, that's to me, who are in Christ. In Christ, we have redemption through his blood, through the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. You see, the depravity of humanity, the sin nature of humanity is so much so that we are disconnected by God. I've heard it asked before, well, how could a perfect God create something that was disconnected or so imperfect that would be disconnected to him? But you see, the reality is that God has given to us a free will choice to live our lives the way we choose to live, to make the decisions, to walk the paths that we've walked. And because of the decisions, the free will choice that we have, we choose through our own lives depravity or the nature of sin. I have a 4-year-old little boy. I never taught him how to lie. But the first time he took candy or a cookie that he wasn't supposed to have, and I asked him, did mom say that that was okay? The very first thing he said is, yes. Never had to teach him. It may not be that your sins are great. May not be that your sins are numerous. You may say, well, I don't feel like I've done very much in my life. But you see, the very nature of humanity brings us to a place of separation and opposition to God. But because of Jesus Christ, praise God, there's a result. Because of the resurrection, because he didn't just stay in the grave, but he rose on the third day, the result for you and I is we have been forgiven of our depravity. That which separates us, that removes us from God, now we have been forgiven, and now we have been given this wonderful thing called grace. I love how it says in verse number 8, it says, his grace, which he makes abound towards us in all wisdom and in prudence. Abounding towards literally means leaping to, running to, overshadowing, overfilling us with his grace. You see, God's grace is his sovereign divine ability to get the job done on our behalf when we can't do it. God's grace is what enables us to be who he has called us to be, so that we can live a life that is in the reality, that is in the result of his resurrection, that is a life that reflects his glory. It's because of the grace of God we can live a life unto Jesus Christ. And he says that he has given us his grace, which abounds to us in wisdom and in prudence. Verse number 9 says, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. Church, understand God's desire for you. The result is God doesn't want you to live in a shroud of darkness to not understand. God's not trying to confuse your life. He's not a God of confusion. Jesus Christ said some succinct words that on the third day the sun would rise, and Jesus Christ fulfilled his words. that God made his plans known to man, that you and I shouldn't walk our lives as though we're groping around in the darkness trying to grab a hold of something. We have been given the light of the world as our direction because of his resurrection. The Bible says that the word guides our feet. Jesus has given us the directions of his word to guide us in our lives so that God would lead us and direct us in everything. The result of the resurrection is our forgiveness of our sins, God's grace that enables us to become who God has called us to be. I love how it goes on and it says even more, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. God is reconciling all things to Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us that he's the name above all other names. He's the principality or the power above all other powers. That every knee shall bow and every tongue confess the name of Jesus Christ. You see, you in your life and me in my life, because of the decisions, because of the directions that we took, we walked astray from God. But here, this word reconcile, God is literally taking his arm and reaching out and grabbing us from the muck and the mire and the darkness of our life and beginning to pull us in, drawing us in, bringing us in to God's goodness, to God's glory, to God's presence, to his ever-changing word and the power of God. We are being reconciled to Jesus Christ, brought in to Christ. I love that. And the Bible says in verse number 11, in him we have obtained an inheritance. The result of the resurrection of Jesus Christ is that you are no longer bound to the surname of your family. The inheritance that you have are not the sins of the father passed on to the son. The inheritance of your life is no longer the genealogy of your father and your grandfather and your great-grandfather and so on and so on. You don't have to live according to the ways of your old family, the ways of your past. Your inheritance is no longer the things that you have done. Your inheritance is now brought into glory by God. I was thinking about, as the Lord was giving to each of the tribes of Israel their inheritance, he was giving them lands of Canaan and their position. The tribe of Levi was not given any land. You might think, oh my goodness, they got left over. But they were given the inheritance of position. You see, church, you and I, our inheritance is not the finances that we have. Our inheritance is not what our parents leave us behind. Our inheritance is not what we have to make for ourselves. Our inheritance now is the glory of God. Just like the tribe of Levi, we are now the richest people on the face of the earth, not because of finances, not because of possessions, but because we have been given the position of our God Almighty. And we are now brought into the family, made into the family, adopted as children of God. You're no longer who you once were. Now, through Jesus Christ, the result of his resurrection, church, you are children of God. You are a royal priesthood. You are king's kids. That is now your inheritance. The Bible goes on and it says, being predestined. No, go back. Being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things. Jesus Christ saw you on that cross, who for the joy set before him, as the book of Hebrews says, endured despise and shame of the cross. He saw you on that cross. You see, you are called for such a time as this. Just like the end of a game, they send out the best players to make sure the win. You and I are called for such a time as this. God saw each and every one of you in his eyes when Jesus died on the cross. And now, as the world is literally tearing itself apart, here we are in this time to serve a purpose for the kingdom of Jesus Christ, to tell a lost and dying world, we are God's dream team called for this time, the result of his resurrection. So good. So exciting. Verse number 12, he goes on and he says, we've trusted in Christ to be the praise of his glory. Verse number 13, and because we have heard and trusted, Jesus Christ is to be trusted. He didn't say the Son of Man would rise after 3 days and stay in the grave. What Jesus Christ said, he accomplished. Which means for you and I, we have trust in Christ. Our trust is no longer in the financial sector. Our trust, as we learned in 2008 and 2009, is not in Wall Street or in the real estate market. Our trust isn't in the administration of the United States. Our trust is in Jesus Christ alone. Because what Jesus says, he fulfills in our lives. And the beautiful part about it is it says, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Verse number 14. Who is the guarantee of our inheritance? I remember there's times in my life where I've given somebody money waiting for a product or something, a service. And maybe it took a couple of days or a couple of weeks. And after a while, I don't see anything happening. I'm thinking, oh my goodness, I gave them my money. Did they take it? What kind of guarantee do I have? What's to stop them from not showing up? What's to stop them from not doing anything? But you see, Jesus Christ didn't rise from the dead and go to heaven with God and say, hey, hang out and trust in me and I'll come back. He says, no, I will leave you a guarantee. You see, God left us his Spirit, his Holy Spirit, to dwell on the inside of humanity, that we might become the temple of the Most High God, that the presence of God no longer is somewhere off to be longed for. The presence of God exists on the inside of us because of the guarantee of the Word of God, the Holy Spirit. You see, the result of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, church, is that we have been forgiven. That we have been adopted, have been brought into a new family, have been given an inheritance, have been reconciled, and have been filled with the Spirit of God. So when Paul the Apostle says in Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. The life that I now live in the flesh, I live to the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You see, church, the result of the resurrection of Jesus Christ for you and I is that we have been resurrected from death into new life. The life that we live, we now live through Jesus Christ, who came to give us life and life more abundance. You're no longer bound by death, no longer bound by the past, no longer bound by the mistakes of your life and the decisions that you've made. The life that you live, you now look forward because you have an inheritance, you have forgiveness, you have grace, you have mercy, you have adoption, you have the Holy Spirit. The result of God is that you have been given new life through Jesus Christ. That is a reason, church, to celebrate God Almighty. Let's praise him in the house today. Hallelujah. God is good. Jesus Christ is worthy to be praised on this Easter Sunday. Before we leave, we won't let you out in just a couple of minutes. I want to ask you, do me a favor, just keep your seats. Don't get up, don't leave. I promise I'll let you out in just a couple of minutes. But before we leave today, we're talking about the reality, the fact that it happened. The reach is that God's gift of Jesus Christ is for all humanity, which includes you. The result is that you have been resurrected into new life. But there are those of you in this place today that maybe you don't know Jesus. Maybe you don't live in the result of his resurrection yet. But we want to give you that opportunity today. I want you to examine your heart. Just look into your heart. Look into your life. Nobody would know the answer. Nobody would know the condition or the state of your soul except you and God. Make it personal. Hey, don't beat around the bush. Don't try to make anything else. But if you were to die today and you were to leave this place and die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? See, how you answer that says a lot about your position with God. You know, oftentimes we think, well, if I hope so, or I want to, or I desire, man, I really want to go to heaven, that God looks at us and says, man, that's good enough. But did you know that nowhere in God's word can you hope, want, wish, or desire your way into heaven? Listen, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you that you were a Christian when you were a child growing up, or that because you attended church growing up, or even because you're here today, well, God must love people who attend church, and because I've got a gold star church attendance record, I must get into heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you go to church, that you're going to get into heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you went to Sunday school classes or you were baptized as a baby, that you've got a cross around your neck or a tattoo somewhere on your body that has a scripture reference. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that that means that you're going to get into heaven? Oftentimes people think, well, that I'm not a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Muslim or anything like that. I always thought that meant by default I was going to go to heaven. I was right with God in his eyes. But did you know that nowhere in God's word does it say that there's a system of classifications by default you're going to get into heaven? I was talking to somebody once and they said, man, I got to live the good life because I don't want to go to hell. So often in America, we think that if we're good, if we give to the Red Cross or we try to help out our fellow human being, we stand for social justice. That means that if we live a good life, good people go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in God's holy word does it say that good people go to heaven? The Bible tells us according to God's righteousness, our good deeds are like filthy rags. You see, nothing you and I could ever do would ever make us good enough on the outside. Why? Because you can't buy it. You can't earn it. You can't work for it. Your salvation, your right standing with God comes to you and me as a gift through Jesus Christ. Which means we can't do it any other way but God's way. Jesus said these words, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. Today I want to give you the opportunity to accept the gift, the Bible says, of God is eternal salvation. In the book of John in the 3rd chapter, the very same scripture, the very same conversation that we know as John 3:16, for God so loved the world, Jesus is talking to a religious leader. And he says to this religious leader, in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. Now listen, that doesn't mean what you think, what Hollywood or movies or society's made it out to be. Born again from the beginning of God's word to the end has always meant the same thing in his heart and in his mind. It means that you've given God all of your heart, you've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God through his son, Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to the church, people like you and I. And Jesus says, I'd rather find that you're hot or cold, because he says, if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Shocking statement from the mouth of Jesus. And what Jesus is saying is that lukewarm Christians will be ejected, expelled from the kingdom of God. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Simply put, let's talk about that. Lukewarm means that you've got your ups and your downs in your relationship, your ins and your outs. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. Come on, let's be honest. If you were to go to any relationship you had on earth, friend, family, children, and you were to say, you know what, I only want to give you a little bit of my time, you know that that relationship would never succeed, yet we think that we can give God one day a week, a month, a year, and think that that makes us okay with God. When in place of our sins, God gave his everything. Jesus. So in return, he wants all of our hearts, all of our lives. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. In just a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go 1, 2, and on the count of three, I'll go 3, and I'll smack my hands together. I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying, Pastor Luke, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus said these words. He said that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. He says, but if you deny him, he will deny you. The decision's yours. God's not a manipulator, not a conniver. He won't force his way or kick his way in. Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. Whoever opens the door, I'll come in and dine with him. The decision is yours to accept or to reject the gift of God through Jesus Christ and eternal salvation. It's not even so much about what happens when you die. Jesus says, I have come to give you life. Give it more abundantly. If you've got that void on the inside that you can't seem to fill, it's a void that can only be filled by the love of God. Today is your day to accept that gift of salvation and life through Jesus Christ. Who should raise your hands? If you've never given him your heart, you've never given him your life. If that's you, in just a moment, get ready, pop your hands up. If you're not sure, in just a moment, get ready, pop your hands up. Maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group at a Harvest Crusade. Maybe you prayed that prayer once before, but you never really followed through. If that's you, get ready in just a moment, pop your hand up. I'll see it. Maybe you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God, saying, hey, come on, let's make this the day you go forward in your relationship with God through Jesus Christ, leaving the past behind, ensuring your eternal destiny with God in paradise. God's not in the business of condemning men to hell. He's in the business of redeeming men to heaven through Jesus. And it starts by making the decision to follow him. Say, man, if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. Listen, I'm not going to embarrass you. This is the best decision you can make. And today is the best day for you to make that decision. All across this auditorium, from the front to the back, from the side to side, even if you're outside in the campus or watching in the foyer or online at your computer at your home, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time. In just a moment, when I count to three, I want you to pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. Put it right back down, and we'll follow through together all throughout this place. I'm going to count to three. If that's you, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. I see you guys over there. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32 back there. 33, 34, 35, 36 back there in the back. 37, I see you guys right back there. Where are you at? You say, man, I wonder if I should have. 38, I got your hand right there. 38, 39, see the usher's pointing over in this direction. All right, I got you, my man. 40, 41, I got you back there right over here. All right, I got you, my man. 40 or so wise people. Hey, let's give God a great big praise. Hallelujah. God is so good. Let's do this for all of you that raised your hands. And for those of you that didn't, but you know you should have, the Bible says it's the goodness of God, and you know who you are. God is speaking to you. Here's what we're going to do. You say, I want to make the decision. I want to follow Christ. Now it's time to follow through with you making that decision by putting action to it, and we're going to do that together. So in just a moment, we're all going to stand. Elijah's going to sing a song, and as we do, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, a friend if you need a friend. Bring your entire family with you if you want. Get out of your seat, get out of your chair. If you're in the family rooms, the ushers will help you grab your stuff. I want you to get into the aisles and come meet me right here. I want to congratulate you. Let's change destinies together. So let's all stand. If you raised your hand or you should have, come on, come meet me right here. We're changing
Jesus,
destinies right now.
I believe in you. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe.
Wherever you're at, you come.
Jesus, I believe.
All over the place.
You. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. You're the reason
you come.
That
come
I
on.
Breathe.
This is for you.
Jesus, I believe.
They're still coming. Come on. We'll wait for you guys.
You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe.
And they're still coming. Come on.
Jesus, I believe. Oh, yes, I do. Jesus, I believe.
Praise God. They're still coming. Praise God as you come. Come on. Hey, listen, guys, I want to tell you something. You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. Today's the first day of the rest of your lives. You know what's really cool? We just plundered hell. Robbed the devil of destroying your life. Jesus Christ can change your life. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on, I promise, all right? I promise you, nothing weird goes on. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by inviting God, Jesus, to come into your heart, to be the Lord and Savior. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? The leader of your life. So he's going to lead you in a prayer. Second thing he's going to do is give you some free information, easy reading. As you walk out of here today, he can point you in the right direction and say, what do I do next? We're going to set you on the right path. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want you to come back and hang out with us. We'll connect you with a friend, somebody that will meet with you right here at church. They'll buy you a cup of coffee or get you a soda right in our cafe for free. Sit down with you for a couple of weeks. You're not joining a big, long program. They just want to get with you, meet with you, teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God so you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from. So if y'all would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Hallelujah. Congratulations. Praise God.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer, of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.